Mic check, mic check. Let's see if we have audio. So I'm wearing my cool glasses here because I want everything to look pretty. Let's see if we are live on YouTube. We're doing the stream through my phone again because I have not had time to deal with the software. And because of that, I decided to just use my phone, move forward, and see what we can do here to just keep the stream going like we promised. Anyway, okay, you don't need to be orange. I got these from Fritz last weekend, and I really enjoyed them because they let me take peeks at corals without having to use a gel. And it's kind of a cheat. It's funny, you see a few people walking around like this. Hello, please let me know. James, if you can hear me, because you're the first one in the room. And I'm gonna jump here. No lag. Well, yeah, because we're on the phone. So the only downside is if this app crashes, I have to restart it. But hopefully we can just move forward just this weekend until I can make things even better. All right. Yes. Okay. Thank you very much for letting me know that the audio works. Today's topic is going to be about moving tanks. And it's something I've been wanting to talk about for the last couple of weeks, but I kind of held off. And I was talking with a friend last night who's talking about moving houses. And he said, well, I guess I know what your live stream is going to be about tomorrow. And he's right. It's a big deal. So there's a lot involved, and we're going to jump into that. But before we start that topic, I just want to let you know, on the 17th, I will be in Indianapolis. I'm going to be there for less than a day. I'm flying in the night before. There's a frag swap there at Indy Mass. And feel free to come attend. I'm sure they'd love to see you there. I'd be happy to meet with you and talk. And then after that, I've got to fly home. So it's a real quick trip, but I wanted to make sure to tell you guys right now so you can't say, I didn't know. I'm looking at the quality on my screen. Yeah, it says the video quality is low. How is that even possible? Because we have a nice clean connection. I have an idea. Ugh, this is probably not a good decision to make, but let me do this. I'm back. What I did was I turned off the Wi-Fi. So now we're on LTE. Let's see what happens. I hope it'll just continue and be good. Wow, that's a great frozen screen. But, oh yeah, that already looks better to me. How's it look to you guys? All right, give me a second here. Okay. Ryan said he just moved his 13-gallon tank yesterday and everything went well. Well, I'm going to take you the exact opposite direction of that. Let's just talk about a bigger tank. And I really, there's a lot to cover, and we only have so much time to do it. Here's the thing. Most people set up kind of a large tank in their house. I know there's a lot of people out there with nanos. Usually it's because they're new to the hobby. They want to start small. It totally makes sense. I agree that is the wise move. But eventually you upgrade. And then once you get your really big tank, you discover you have to move for whatever reason. Job, marriage, you found a better house. The apartment complex you're in is closing down. I mean, there's all kinds of reasons why people have to move. And when it's time to move that big tank to the new location, all the livestock in there is at risk. And that is super difficult to deal with. And bottom line, I mean, I'm just going to boil it down and then I'm going to expand. You need a ton of luck if you're going to be able to move all your livestock successfully. And there have been people over the years that said, I am going to move from the West Coast to the East Coast. I'm going to take all my livestock, all my corals, you know, everything. I'm going to document it. I'm going to do this amazing article about it. And then the article never happens. Why? Because it doesn't work out. It's really frustrating. It's heartbreaking. And the thing is that all the livestock is struggling to stay alive every minute it's not in the tank. And while corals are shipped all over the world, they're probably not stressed from being ripped out of a tank before they're bagged up and transferred, first of all. I'm going to kind of delve into my buddy's situation. He lives in a house right now. It's a rent house. He wants to buy a nice house. And he's got it's like a 210 plus a 60-gallon. And I told him, I said, the best bet you could possibly do is you buy a new tank for the new house, you set it up, You get it cycled, running, even if it's a quick cycle, just anything to stabilize that system, and then come get your livestock and drive all the way back with it and put it in the new tank. But to take everything out of the tank, take the tank down, take the tank out the door, load it up on your car or trailer or truck, drive all the way to your destination, set up the existing aquarium, get all the livestock back into it, and expect miracles, I mean, because that's what you're doing. You're looking for a miracle. It's not likely to work out. And that is the hard part of this, because you've had fish for many years, you've grown frags, you know, into huge colonies. That kind of livestock hates it. So invariably, most people tend to sell off their livestock and move the equipment because there's no stress involved. You pack up your pumps after you clean them, and then you say, in 6 months, I'm setting up my tank, you know, when I'm all stabilized. Now, let's say you're stubborn. You know, let's say you're me and you're stubborn. Like, I am doing this. I don't care what it takes. I will this thing into reality. What will happen is you're going to lose some corals. You might even lose some fish. But you can plan ahead as best possible. But ideally, set up the new tank first. And when I say that, I'm actually telling you to pay an extra month's rent wherever you live now so that it can sit there and idle and hopefully be okay while you're back and forth all the time. And the day you're moving, and you're moving all your furniture, and you're moving all your kitchen stuff, and you're moving all your frozen and your fresh food, and you know, you're moving all the things that are in your garage or your basement or your attic and an aquarium, that's a lot to ask of anyone. So I don't recommend that. And I really would suggest you get other people to do all that moving, and they, you know, they pack it, they box it, they get in the truck, they do all that, and you focus on the tank. But think about it. When you've got a tank, you've also got trash cans, tubing, barrels, RO system, backup tanks, quarantine tanks. You got the rock, you've got the sand, you've got all the livestock itself, you've got your lighting canopy stand. You have so much for that aquarium. Matter of fact, if you start looking around your house, you'll be shocked at all the stuff you have everywhere, all related to the tank. All of it has to move with you. So you have to think ahead. You have to have the situation set up at the new home with the right electricity. In other words, is there enough circuits for that new tank? Is there anything that's going to be in the way? Is there going to be any furniture in your way as you're coming in with the livestock? Basically, you want a clear path where nothing is in your way. These are all the things you have to overcome. So if you have to move a tank across the room, across town, or across state lines, it's a pain in the butt. It is not a simple thing to do. And, you know, we're going to talk about some of the things you can do to avert disaster. Why is it when I get on the live stream, then my throat starts to mess up? All right. Let's talk about, you just have to move the tank a few feet because you're getting new carpet put in your home. Okay? If it's a small tank, the first thing you can do is put a trash can right in front of the tank, a nice clean one that's only for salt water. If it's ever been used for trash, clean it really well. I'd recommend you just get a salt water only trash can, you know, one for making salt water. And I would drain a lot of the water out of the tank to where it's very shallow. And I would take the fish and move them into the trash can, move the rock into the trash can, you know, kind of arrange your corals. Get a heater in there, get a powerhead in there, maybe get an airstone in there and oxygenate. And now the trash can has a handle on each side, and you and a buddy can move it across the floor. You can technically drag it by yourself, but if you can have some help, that would be great. Because you still have to move the aquarium and a stand. And you might be able to use furniture sliders, which are awesome. You'll just have to tilt the tank up a little bit, and since the tank is 95% empty now, you're not going to stress the seams. You can put the furniture sliders under there, and you know, under all four corners, and you can just shoot across the floor, which is lovely. It's just fantastic. And I love doing that for big, heavy objects when I'm by myself. But if that's not an option or you need to work with a buddy, you can just take the tank off itself and move it. And then, you know, get the stand and move it. And now get it hooked up or do whatever you're going to do. Like when I had to replace my carpet, I ended up taking the tank outside and cleaning it thoroughly. And I even reversed the tank because it was a 29-gallon. Easy tank, right? Small. I cleaned up all the gravel because I had gravel. I had a crushed coral and it was full of crap. And so I cleaned all that out. I scraped the glass on all four sides. I discovered, because I already knew, but I mean, you just see these things like, oh, okay. The back of the tank had zero scratches on the glass because, you know, the front is what usually gets dinged. So I turned the tank around and now I had a nice brand new front panel and I put the scratch panel against the back. And once the guys were done with the carpet, I brought the stand back in, put the tank on, put the clean. I think I switched to sand at that point. And then I put in my rock work and my livestock, and it never skipped a beat. But that was 10 feet. If you need to move a tank a few inches away from the wall, I got a trick for you. See, I'm dumping all this knowledge on you. I hope it'll help you at some point. So I realize some viewers may not watch every word. That's your choice. You're just missing the good stuff. All right. Drain the tank down as much as you can. You know, just drain water. You know, pump the water out, basically. So pump it out quickly into a trash can or two so your tank is excessively lighter. And then put a 2x4 behind... Okay, the space between the aquarium and the wall, I want you to slide a 2x4 behind that. And then I want you to grab the end of the 2x4 and pull it, and it will force the tank forward. Go to the opposite side, put a 2x4 behind it. You know, you're using the wall as leverage, and you pull the board this way, and you'll end up with a tank that's moved forward a couple inches, and it's not quite touching the wall. Now, why would you want to move a tank forward just a couple of inches? Maybe you're wanting to install some type of filtration or a hang-on-back overflow box, or you're tired of the salt creep damaging the sheetrock, and if it would just be 2 inches away from the wall would hold up better. So that is my technique for moving a tank. And then, of course, once you scooted it forward, which took you all of, 90 seconds, maybe 2 minutes, pump the water back in the tank. That's it. The problem is resolved. Make sure it's level. And you have to use a level for that. A nice big one. I know you want to use the level app in your phone and set the phone on top and say, good to go. But the phone's this long and your tank is this long. It'd be much better to have a full-length level. And that way you know for sure that it's good. You want to make sure when you're walking around the tank, it doesn't rock back and forth. You know, it doesn't as you're stepping. Matter of fact, get in front of the tank and bounce up and down and see if the tank wiggles. If it does, you need to shim it up, especially the front. It's better if the tank goes toward the wall than toward you, especially if there's kids in the house. Always make sure your tank is stable. Okay, so that was an easy, quick move the tank a little bit away from the wall or a small tank, break it down and take it outside. But if you're having to move it to an entire different room, you may discover, number one, electricity is going to be a problem. You may not have nearly enough outlets or circuits to support the system, which means you might need to get someone in there to wire in some stuff before you even do this. So that's where I'm talking about moving. You want to plan ahead. Now's your chance. When I was picking up a 55-gallon aquarium that I bought used a long time ago, I had one outlet on that wall, and I knew I had, you know, a dozen plugs. And so I had an electrician add a second circuit right behind that tank, and we ran it right through the attic to the breaker box, and boom, I had two circuits, which I could do 6 plugs in each one, and the tank never had a glitch where it would pop a breaker. So that's good. If you are moving out of state, or if you're moving to a different town, you know, I'm in Texas. It takes forever to get out of here. So, if I'm heading to San Antonio, it's 5 hours away. For some of you guys in the northeastern states, you could cross 3 straits in 5 hours. But, you know, for us, it's a long drive, and we consider that one state. But let's say you had to move your livestock from here to San Antonio, which is a 5-hour drive. You've got to break all your corals off the rock. And you might say, oh, I don't want to do that. They're all encrusted. They're beautiful. Well, by breaking them off, you are actually protecting them. Because if you got this rock with a coral on it, you try and take that rock with you, if it moves during transport, odds are that coral's going to get broken anyway. So what you can do is you can break off the corals and you can put them inside a styrofoam cooler with salt water, with before you leave the door, you could put a powerhead in there or a powerhead and heater, you know, while you're still at home. And, keep the circulation going. Those corals are going to be stressed. They're going to be releasing crap into the water. You're going to possibly want to change that water out before you even start driving. The other choice is to bag each coral separately. But if you're doing that, I'd almost suggest it's so hard to do this successfully. But if you can cut off the corals in advance, like the day before, so the stress is out of their system, and then you plop them into bags, you're going to bag them up with water, maybe double bag them, triple bag them, set them in the cooler. This is just how fish stores receive them. And you've got all these corals. There's a good chance the big colonies are going to go up in smoke. I came home with 8 frags from my trip to Seattle. And 2 of them were relatively big. And both of those died before they ever got into my tank. A tiny one that looked like a little snippet off of a colony went up in smoke too. But the 5 other frags that are like frags on a frag plug, I shoved them all in the sand bed at the bottom of my tank, and every one of them is polyped out and happy right now. So small frags are going to move a lot better than colonies. And colonies are used to exactly their conditions, and you're changing it all right now with this big move. Even if you think it's only going to last 6 hours, 12 hours, 18 hours, 24 hours, whatever you think it's going to be, you're going to affect them. They're going to not like what you're doing, and they can respond, and they can go downhill. But, okay, so you got the corals in the cooler. You have choices. You can make like an egg crate rack and put corals on there and another rack on top and more corals and fill it up with water and then seal the lid, tape the lid, put it in a box, you know, add heat packs. I would also recommend when you're moving, find a very mild day, you know, a day that's in the 70s. It's not cold. It's not hot. So your water won't have to be chilled. Your water won't have to be heated. Those are that would be ideal. If it at all possible, try to hit a mild day. Today, our weather here is 81 degrees. People in Pennsylvania, their weather is like 30s. I would not want to move a tank in the 30s. Now, you've got your livestock, your corals in a cooler. You still got a tank with rock and fish. This is the next step. You're going to drain water out of the tank and into trash cans, big, heavy duty, like the Brute 44. And I would take the rock out of the tank and put it right in that salt water you drained out of your tank. And so what's going to happen is you're filling each trash can about halfway and then enough water to cover it and then put the lid on top. And two people haul that outside and put it in the truck. And you do that with as many trash cans as you need. Don't try to fill the trash can to the top with rock because, number one, you're not going to be able to move it once it's full of water because you'll be dealing with like 600, 700, 800 pounds. And you got to get it into the truck and out of the truck and into the new house. Just do halfway. And as long as the rock is completely submerged the entire time, it won't cycle. Because that is the thing people are trying to avert. They don't want to set up their tank and have all their livestock start to release ammonia into the water. And the reason ammonia usually happens is because there is sponges on the rock, and the sponges exposed to air die. And of course, they release ammonia, creates a cycle, and it just kind of snowballs. So pull the rock out, put it right back into the water. It's been out of water 10 seconds. It didn't even know. And anything that had coral tissue, because you had your rock and you broke the coral off, there's still a patch of tissue. You can kind of stack the rock in the barrel. Ideally, put the base rock in the bottom of the barrel and then the rock with the bits of coral on the top so they're facing upward. And that way, in theory, you'll know which rocks you care about. Because let's say you had a Walt Disney colony, okay? You went way beyond a frag. You got this amazing colony and there's some tissue left and you're saying to yourself, that's, you know, worth $1,000 per millimeter, and I don't want any bit of it to die, then you definitely don't want to put that rock upside down in the tank and kill that part because you didn't see it. So facing everything upward that had some coral life on it would be smart. Then you drain more water out of the tank so it's about this deep, and all the fish are swimming near the bottom, and there's no rock in the way, there's no corals in the way, and you can scoop them all out with a net. And you can put them into another barrel, which would be just salt water and an air stone, and move all the fish in there. Put all the fish together. The fish will not fight. They're all freaking out. They don't understand what happened in this dark barrel. And always have an oxygen pump on that barrel until the minute you leave. And then at your destination, as soon as you pull up, the barrel of fish goes inside and you plug it into the wall and you get some air going into it, possibly a heater going into it if the water temperature is dropping. I love glass thermometers. I would put them in everything during your transport so you can constantly check temperature. If you're traveling a long distance, you may need to run air stones into the livestock containers, whether it's the styrofoam or the barrel, using power inverters and a battery-powered air pump. You can use the air pumps they use for fishermen that want to keep their bait alive. They use a couple of D batteries, and that will just bubble for hours and hours. And that can keep oxygen in there, which is great. The fish are going to need it. The corals don't need as much, but they could use some. So if you have this huge, long trip, you know, 6, 8, 10 hours, using one or two power inverters with, you know, a little bit of heater and definitely some air bubbling in the water will be the best chance at success. And then as soon as you get to your destination, make sure nothing is in your way. There can't be anything on the floor, in the hallway, across the walkways, near the front door. You don't want mattresses leaning against the wall and you're going to scooch past it. You don't want rolled up carpet where you could trip. You want to be able to make sure you can carry that tank successfully into the tank, into the house. If your tank is already there, so much the better. That's where we're back to where I talked about 10 minutes ago, where I said pay an extra month's rent, set up your new tank, and get it stable. Now you show up with your livestock, move all your livestock into that tank. And there's a better chance of success. Not 100% guaranteed, but a better chance of success. The all the other stuff you hauled with you, you know, your old 210-gallon tank or your 180 or whatever, maybe you didn't sell it, maybe you didn't Craigslist it, and you still have it, all that can move in later. Livestock comes first. It comes ahead of everything. It's more important than putting bookcases in the new house. It's more important than getting the bed in place. It's more important, you know, than even getting your food in the fridge. I mean, these fish and corals can't wait. So they become your absolute number one importance. And if you can do that, then, and if you have a lot of luck, you'll be okay. Now let's talk about moving an aquarium itself. I always use suction cups, and they have these big, huge suction cups. I should have brought one over here for the video. But you put on, you, the first thing you do with your tank, let's say you're moving a tank and you're gonna move it from here to there, and you've gotta use it, clean the outside of the tank really well on all four sides. Oh, look, we have a guy that wants to be banned. Maybe that'll help. Okay. Now, if you're trying to move your aquarium, the salt that's on it, even a thin film will make it slippery, and you could drop the tank. And if that tank is the future of your livestock, nobody drops the tank. That's the number one rule. Do not drop the tank. Have plenty of helpers. Get suction cups. In my case, I've had to move some really big tanks over the years. A 280, the 400 three times, a 215 twice. Lots of tank moves. I always use suction cups. And what I did was I went to the two different fish stores in the local area, and I said, I'm gonna need them on Saturday. And I got four from this store and four from that store. I got furniture dollies. I got straps, like the ratchet straps. And I put that all together, and I got all these people over here to help me move my tank. And you want the same thing. You want plenty of helpers. Do not think just you and a buddy can handle it. Tanks are heavy. Tanks are awkward. Tanks are fragile. And so you're going to want to have a good, secure grip on it. You want to make sure the suction cups are really holding on well. Yes, you can use suction cups on an acrylic tank, too. The suction cup is, I don't know. Possibly 8 inches in diameter, and it's got a plunger on the side, and as you pump that, it will grab onto the glass or grab onto the acrylic. If the back of the tank is painted, if the back of the tank is some kind of a film, the suction cup needs to be on a solid surface. If it is like half on, half off, it can pop off. I watched a guy do that during one tank move when I went over there to help, and he almost gave himself a black eye because it just popped off and, you know, fist in the face. So you have to place them. Matter of fact, if you're in charge, go around and make sure every suction cup is good. Don't just assume they got it. I got it. No. Let me double check your work, and because it's your tank. And then you all bring it in, and you're basically carrying it in like a coffin, okay? You know exactly what that looks like. So you're going to bring it in. If it's super heavy, I would use furniture dollies, and these are the ones that are four boards connected with wheels on the bottom. And you set your tank on top of it, and then you put a ratchet strap around the tank and the dolly. So as you're pushing it across the ground or down a hallway and you get to a threshold and you have to lift it, as you lift the tank upward, which you can do with suction cups, then the dolly will come with it and go over the threshold and continue rolling like out to the truck. And if you rent a truck to move, I would suggest paying a little bit more for the big truck that has the ramp. So you can roll it up the ramp and into there. But if you have tons of people and you guys want to lift the tank up, I guess 3.5 feet up into the air, you can slide it into the back of the truck. The nice thing about having the big truck is that you can put the tank in there, the stand in there, the canopy in there, your barrels of salt water and rock, your all that stuff, and then your livestock can go in a vehicle where the water, where the air temperature of the, you know, the internal area of the car is stable, and that should help your livestock stay stable, you know, so it won't get too cold. It's not in the back of a big giant truck bouncing around through the potholes. So that would be my suggestion there. The other thing I want to tell you that I think is really, really important is to make tons of extra salt water. Just have a lot of salt water ready on both ends. If something goes wrong and you're just losing salt water, like as you're moving out, and you know, let's say the trash can cracks open and all the water pours out and there went 30 gallons of water you needed, having more salt water ready, you can kind of restore and move on. So make a lot of salt water for the packing up process. and have a bunch of salt water ready on the other end in case you need it when you get there. And think about this. You just moved all your livestock into a tank. It's been 24 hours. It's been, 36, 48 hours, and water parameters are getting out of whack. You've got all that water to make another quick water change to kind of get things stabilized. You can add Seachem Prime to the water to lock up ammonia, nitrate, nitrite, chloramine, chlorine. I mean, all the stuff that's evil. Prime is awesome. It's reef safe. A cap full treats 50 gallons. A big bottle will take care of your entire move. I wouldn't necessarily use it preemptively during the move. Like, I wouldn't put it into the barrel of rock and water. I wouldn't put it into the barrel with a fish. But once they're in the big tank, I would do it at that point. And you're going to want to aquascape. I understand that. But since you're in this transfer situation, get the rock in the tank underwater as quickly as possible and just kind of work with the rock as best you can. It's not like you can stack it all beautiful because you're in the middle of a move. Now, if you pre-set up a tank while the other tank is running and it's stable and it's good at the old destination, yeah, you can aquascape that thing. I mean, it comes down to how much time you have. If you've got 2-3 months before you physically move over and you're paying property, house payment and rent on both at the same time, all that time, that's fine. That will give you more success. But don't try to tackle everything. Focus on making sure everything's super stable with a new tank and then get everything into it and then keep a close eye and test the water like crazy. I mean, test it daily. Watch the livestock. If you see something going amiss, deal with it. Don't sit there and say, well, maybe it'll be okay. You might have to pull a few corals that just aren't going to make it. And as they die, they throw their crap on the next coral that was healthy. And that one can go like dominoes, so you don't want that to happen either. So for some reason, we just keep having nice people chatting crap in here. Okay, Heinrich suggested using Dr. Tim's product. Yes, you can use Microbacter 7, you can use Dr. Tim's, you can use Fritz Turbo Start. There's a product from ATM you can use. These are all things that you can use to add bacteria to your tank to help with the brand new super heavy bio load it's getting all of a sudden. And that bio load might be the same one you had before, but it's a stressed bio load. It's not a normal, mundane one. So I would suggest that you you think ahead in that regard and buy all these products. Check your water. Okay, that's it. I've said that. I'm not going to repeat myself. Let's see. Let me see if I can answer any questions for you. Feel free. I guess I'll scroll up and see how much the damage was in the chat room today. Okay, Tom Winter asked a question about, are there any tips about changing out the rockscape? Currently creating a new aquascape to replace the old one. And I would think this isn't a tank you're not moving. You're just talking about just in general. The number one rule of aquascaping is not to look man-made. Don't make it look like a brick wall. Don't make it look flat. If it looks straight, it looks completely unnatural. There's nothing in nature that's straight. And, there's always some kind of a slight tilt, a curvature to it. And anything you can do to create a random look or, caves and bridges, try to think aesthetically as you're doing it, and then you're going to have to bond it together. You'll have to use like two-part putty. You might use some kind of glue, some kind of an epoxy to hold your rockscape together. Some people will use PVC structures and they zip tie it together, and then they trim and they try to hide that zip tie a little bit. So you want to do that. All right. Ellery said, I will never do a tank move ever again. 8 a.m. to 3 a.m. the next morning. Even with a new tank and water ready set up with new water. See? It's really stressful. And I think that's the hardest part, is you as the owner, you're basically God to those creatures. And every decision you make determines if they live or die. And so you've got to deal with that. And also, here's another thing. If you've got a group of friends over, especially if they're friends in the hobby, that know the hobby, there will be times where you're going to stop and three or four people are going to debate what's the next step. Whoever's in charge needs to make the hard decision. You have to say, we're doing this. We're doing it now. Thank you for your input. And it's not to be rude. You got to keep moving forward. You could stand there for 30 minutes debating what could possibly happen. And in the meantime, you're cutting down on the potential for success. So, make the hard decision or have the other person make the hard decision. If they're a person that's always moved a lot of tanks and they've done it successfully, you could say, okay, I'm leaving it in your hands, but that's a really hard thing. I don't think I could do it. When I was working with Dwayne on my tank back in September last year, I was in charge of my tank. He was in charge of getting the corals out, breaking them up, giving them away, and I focused on my tank. I didn't expect him to focus on my tank. You know, yeah, I talked to him, I had input, we discussed stuff, we talked about putting mini colonies here and there, but that's my tank. And to just say, you have at it, is not acceptable to me. Okay. Reefer Sojourn said, I had to move a 55-gallon once, I'll never do it again. See, moving tanks sucks. I mean, that's it. But we all have to deal with it at some point. What if you have a tank that leaks and you've got to put a new tank in the exact spot where the old tank was leaking? See, you got to move stuff. You got to move everything out. You got to put the livestock into a temporary holding container. You've got to, let's say you're replacing the tank with the exact same size. So the stand can stay, the sump can stay. You just move the canopy out of the way. And you've got to get the livestock out into a container. Then you've got to turn around, move the tank off, put the new tank on, and then, you know, get the livestock back in. Even that's really stressful. And there's some challenges there as well. You can use lots of buckets. That's one thing the Reefer Sojourn also said. He used 10 different buckets. The problem with lots of buckets is you need lots of equipment. Like, let's say you had 10, you know, he said you had 10 buckets. So you need 10 power heads, or you need 10 thermometers, or you need 10 heaters, or, you know, you need 10 plugs. Some of the buckets are just going to hold water temporarily. They don't necessarily have to be agitated. They don't have to have flow. But the ones that have livestock in them, yeah, they're going to need some juice. They're going to need to have some life support. And you can get by for a little while. You can have fish in a bucket for 10 or 15 minutes, but every breath they take is sucking oxygen out. That's why it's so important to have everything ready and have backups of things. If you only have one air pump for this whole project and that thing conks out because it's finally done because you've had it 10 years, you're going to lose everything in the bucket. So try to have duplicates, have doubles. If you can have people come over, they can bring stuff with them. Like one guy, he brought me some furniture dollies. Now I own my own furniture dollies. I've moved them with tanks. I own them. I've got like 4 or 6 of them. Another nice thing that happened for me when I had all these people come over to help, because I told you I borrowed suction cups from 2 different stores. One was from Frank's right here by my house, and the other one was all the way across town. And that one, I would have had to go there after we were done with the, you know, setup. And one of the people lived up there and says, Mark, I'll return those for you on my way home. That was so convenient because I was still dealing with plumbing and, you know, the aquarium itself and all the people in my house. And so having someone that can step up and take care of those little errands. Ideally, if you need something in a hurry from Home Depot, you stay with your tank and your livestock and you send them to go get 1-inch elbows, 1-inch PVC, PVC glue, cement. They can go there. They can text you pictures of what they think you need, unless you can show them. It's this can. See, this is empty. Take it with you. Get me one that's brand new full and come back as quick as you can. You know, that kind of thing. Try to work with your group. Delegate. Stay in control. All right. Savecki's Reef is in Belgium. Hello, Belgium. Thomas Poindexter asks, if I'm building a house, what size dedicated circuit would I need for the equipment? It comes down to the size of the tank. With my big reef, I have a sub panel that has 6 circuit breakers in it. And each of those breakers is 20 amps. But I'm not running 6 times 20. I think my entire setup, and I'm going to do an energy audit here in the very near future and measure everything for you guys, because I want to tell you the latest. Things have changed over the last couple of years. But I think total, my system pulls around, I'm probably telling you wrong, I'm going to say 13 amps, even though it's split across a lot of breakers. And that's so no one breaker will trip. And having lots of circuits is never a bad idea. Bare minimum, I would recommend 2 circuits for any tank. And that way you can split your equipment 50-50, and if one trips, the other half is still running. So if you have power heads and return pumps on 2 different breakers, if the return pump dies, the power heads are still going. If the power heads die, the return pump is going. If you put both power heads and return pump on this one, and you put lights on this one, you got lights and dead livestock. So split your stuff accordingly as best you can. Mm-hmm. Someone says hello from Ireland. Hey, guys. I don't even know what time it is over there. Mike B says, you know, when you're trying to do this, you've got to have the spousal factor. You know, how do you convince your wife to agree to this move or to deal with all this tank stuff? Tell them in advance. Let me give you a comparison. Okay, so sometimes you just have to be blatantly honest with a person, and that way you avoid arguments or hurt feelings. And last week, I had a huge problem with my iPhone that was not resolved quickly in time for my trip to Seattle. And it became an ordeal. And here it was Saturday morning, I'm giving a talk, and I told the person that was driving me, I said, look, on the way there, I am not gonna speak to you in the car at all. I'm gonna be focusing on my presentation. I'm not trying to be rude. I'm not ignoring you. I can't carry a conversation. I literally have to make sure this is right. And he says, nope, that's fine. I'm totally good with it. Let's get you a cup of coffee and get on the road, because we had 40 minutes of drive time. And that allowed me to focus and make sure that presentation was right. And so the same thing, you tell your spouse, look, I know this is a huge move. I know you're worried about the new house. I've got to worry about the tank the whole time. Once the tank is running, I'm yours again. But until then, I need you and the kids to handle all that, or you and the movers and handle all that. Or better yet, you move everything the weekend before, and then the next weekend, it's tank weekend, and you deal with moving the tank from here to there. Like I said, paying the extra rent gives you some window, some breathing room to lower your stress factor, because they're in the house. They got the furniture. They've got the food. They've got the TVs, the Xboxes, all the things they need. And you can focus on moving your tank and not be interrupted and not be told about any kind of mini crisis that's going on. Like the kids are starving. Why aren't you dealing with it? Okay, my screen froze for a second. Hopefully it'll come back. Mm-hmm.